Keep on pushing. Keep on pushing. Good afternoon. This is Eddie Itwarte here on Pushing Limits radio program, heard on KPFA exclusively. We are one of the, well, we are about the only disability-oriented radio programs in the station, and I think in the Bay Area. We've been here since, since the start of the Iraqi war when Bush invaded Iraq. So since that time, I recall that we did a program basically opposing the war. And so we're still here, and we have gone weekly, as I think some of you folks know. And all, that also means that we're there's more asking of us producers. And we, by the way, we are, all of us are producers with disabilities of various kinds. And that also means that with weekly shows, that there's more opportunity for new folks to come on and work with our program. And folks could be doing anything like researching issues, researching news items, or they could be interviewing, they could be doing editing. So there's a variety of things. And most of us actually came to Pushing Limits without really any experience. So we learned on the job. We were pretty clumsy at first. But now I think we're getting better and better. And nonetheless, I think the best way, perhaps, if you want to contact us, it would be by emailing us at, it's very easy, pushinglimits at kpfa.org. So I wanted to just, again, give a little appeal, a little push to trying to ask new people if they wanted to come on. Anyway, we have a number of news items today, catching up on some news things that maybe the major media or other media don't really pay much attention to. And we're also around midway through the program, we're going to be talking to Sheila Gunn Cushman, who is also one of our production members, and she now works with Emma Martin at the Center for Independent Living. So we'll ask Sheila about the work they are doing regarding emergency preparedness on behalf of people with disabilities, especially in light of the major weather concerns, weather events we've been having recently. Anyhow, I wanted to first of all begin talking about something that's happening in Illinois. And there is a little school district called the Four Rivers Special Education District, which serves about 10 little tiny school districts. And it's special education, so they see only people with special education. And there was one particular school that got some attention and has been getting attention recently, and I think it's a serious stuff. Anyhow, this comes from Disability Scoop, the online disability magazine that's oriented toward people with developmental disabilities. Anyway, from Disability Scoop, Byline Chicago. It says the U.S. Department of Education has opened a civil rights investigation into a tiny Illinois school district for students with disabilities to determine whether children enrolled there have been denied an appropriate education because of the practice of referring students, kids, to law enforcement for misbehaviors. The investigation was initiated in February, 2 months after the Chicago Tribune and ProPublica reported how the district, which operates a therapeutic day school for students with severe emotional and behavioral disabilities, turned to police to arrest students with stunning frequency. For each student in which police were summoned, investigators asked for the reason police got involved, an accounting of how much classroom time was missed and how that time was made up, and records of any communication with parents. district, which also provides special education district services to students in nearby school districts, was given 15 days to respond, and it was directed not to destroy any records. So hopefully we could see some kind of outcome before too long, as the investigation was initiated in the middle of February. A quote from someone called Catherine Lamon, Assistant Secretary for Civil Rights at the Education Department, Federal Education Department, and opening the case, she said, quote, "I emphasize that at this time, OCR, or Office of Civil Rights, has reached no conclusion as to whether the district has violated any OCR enforces." In recent years, though, Garrison administrators called the police to report student misbehavior every other day. On the average, the Chicago Tribune and ProPublica found that's every other day. And there's about only 75 students or so at the small school. Staff members routinely asked to press charges against children, some such as young as 9, and officers arrested them. No other district, not just in Illinois, but in the entire country, had a higher student arrest rate than Four Rivers, according to the most recent federal data that has been made public. That school year, 2017-2018, half of all Garrison students were arrested. Really? The school has fewer than 65 students in most years. 65. Okay. The ProPublica Tribune investigation found that Garrison students had been arrested at least 100 times in the past 5 school years, including 5 students in the first 12 weeks of this school year. Officers typically handcuffed students and took them to the Jacksonville police station, Jacksonville, Illinois, and they were fingerprinted, they were photographed, and placed in the holding cell. There has been no student arrest since November 15, when school administrators called police on a student who had spit at staff members. The student was arrested for aggravated battery, records show. The next day, reporters visited the school for a board meeting and asked questions about Garrison's approach to discipline, including its reliance on police. School officials said they had begun to make changes. So we're going to see what those changes are, and it's happening in Illinois. And by the way, one of the things that always interests me in cases like this is what's the racial makeup of this school district? And actually, it's at least 80% white. So we're not talking about a school district that's abusing brown and black kids. Anyway, that's going on in Illinois, and we'll see if we get more of an update on that. It seems like that whole system ought to just be shut down. throwing 9 children in holding cells and they're 9 years old. Come on. Okay. That's one part of the age spectrum, young people, children. The other part of the age spectrum we wanted to go to today is older folks and adults. And it seems that the Center for Disease Control and Prevention are going to do a study examining as to why people with disabilities are not included in clinical trials. For example, clinical trials for Alzheimer's exclude people with Down syndrome, even though approximately 90% of people with Down syndrome will develop Alzheimer's disease or dementia by age 55. I mean, I didn't know that. You would think they would be part of clinical trials, but they ain't. They haven't been. Not only are people with disabilities at higher risk for many conditions and diseases compared to the general population, disability itself can change the presentation and or management of a disease, and clinicians need to be aware of these differences. Now, what if the Center for Control of Diseases, what if they wanted to do a study on the outcomes of maternal health? And what if they didn't include African-American women or Latina women? particularly African women. American women, because in the African community, the folks there are more affected drastically by infant mortality and infant morbidity, and also mothers with bad outcomes. But apparently, a lot of studies don't even examine are biased against including people with disabilities or some people with disabilities. Anyway, the Center for Disease Control and Prevention, recognizing their problem, they're looking for somebody to they're sending out appeals requests for people to apply to do a report on the situation. The purpose of the report is to address the explicit and implicit exclusion of people with disabilities in clinical trials. Also, the repercussions of exclusion on the disability community, the legal requirements of clinical trial investigators to include people with disabilities in clinical trials, and repercussions for not abiding by those requirements. The final report will provide recommendations and promising practices to increase the acceptance and participation rates of people with disabilities in clinical trials. So that's probably a situation that we have not really heard about too much, but not having excluding people, sometimes even consciously, from clinical trials that these big time institutions do, that sounds pretty fishy. And hopefully that situation is going to change. I think now we're going to have a little bit of music. Stevie Wonder, one of my favorites. And he's, of course, a longtime musician. So we're going to play something, I think an earlier work by his, and it's called Until You Come Back to Me. If you recall, Until You Come Back to Me was recorded, and the biggest hit was by Aretha Franklin. Nice rendition, Stevie Wonder actually recorded this first. It didn't get to play that the Aretha Franklin rendition did, and Stevie Wonder is one of the three co-writers on this song. So let's go back in history, musical history, and listen to a little bit of Stevie Wonder.
Thank you.
Stevie Wonder. That music puts one in a good mood. Hey, Sheila. Sheila Gunn Cushman. Are you there?
I am here.
All right. Sheila is, she's of course, one of our co-producers at Pushing here at Pushing Limits. And she has also, in the last few months, got a position at Center for Independent Living and working with Emma Martin. And what's your actual title over there?
I am the Emergency Preparedness Coordinator for the Center for Independent Living in Berkeley, California.
Okay. And the Center for Independent Living, it's part of a Disability Disaster Access and Resources Program. And that's through the affiliation with California Foundation of Independent Living Centers. And CIL has been awarded funding through something called Listos California, a campaign through the California Governor's Office of Emergency Services. So that's a little bit of the background. And so what are you folks doing? You're doing some individualized emergency preparedness planning. Sheila, what's that all about?
Well, we've been doing a lot lately. Before I go there, I came in on the last bit of your conversation before the song, and I have tried to be a part of medical studies, and they will not let me because I can't read and sign the print forms. So, yeah, inaccessibility and discrimination, So, on to better things. We just came out of an activation from the DDAR program, the Disability Disaster Access and Resources program, where we were open from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. for people to call us if they were in need because their power was out and they needed power to live. They had machines, oxygen machines, sleeping machines, you know, like CPAP machines and things like that, that needed durable medical equipment, that needed power, power chairs, that needed power to be charged. And we can put folks in hotels until their power is restored. We can provide food gift cards while they're in the hotels. We can provide gas. And if the power goes on and off, we want to wait and make sure that they are, if the power goes on and off, we want to make sure that the power stays on so that they don't have to keep popping in and out. And that's what DDAR does as far as emergencies. But we also, between Listos, which is a Cal OES grant, and DDAR, we do a lot of training and preparedness functions where we work with individuals to make their own readiness plans, and we do emergency preparedness 101s where we can go to groups either virtually or in person and do an emergency preparedness presentation and sort of connect people to resources. We also connect people to city and county resources and help them sign up for alerts and things. To make sure that when things happen, they know what's happening. And one of the things that I want to say, and one of the reasons, and thank you for having me, by the way, that I wanted to be here today is it's a sunny day. But as we know, we've had 11 atmospheric rivers already. And it's not over yet. I think it's almost over, but we really can't say. The weather has been hard to track. And then, of course, as soon as that's over, the fire season starts. So what I want people to know is whatever county you're in, they have an alert system. And there is a website called calalerts.org. And I think I'm right. And if I'm not, then go to caloes.org. Let me try that again. Oh, dear. I don't trust my brain. This is what I get for not having notes in front of me. If I can find it fast enough. There is the Access and Functional Needs Office is under the Cal OES, And the access and functional needs is about people with disabilities. And they have a lot of this stuff. They have the Cal disaster, thing that can, you can look at disasters that might be happening in your area or that your area might be prone to. They have the Cal alerts. That is an accessible way to sign up for alerts. And they'll figure out what county you are. They will help make sure that you get what you need. And also the DDAR program is on the CFILC website, California Foundation of Independent Living Centers, which is cfilc.org. I know this is a lot of information. I know these broadcasts are archived, so if you didn't grab a pen, you have more chances. You can always call us, too, at 510-841-4776. My extension is 3190. Again, 510-841-4776. I can also give my direct line, which is 510-422-5068. That's 510-422-5068. And we are here to make folks prepared so that they don't get caught out in the rain. I guess more figuratively than literally, you might get wet, but at least you won't get in deep, deep trouble.
Okay. But the thing is, for anybody, because probably some people that have disabilities or not, they're not living in the catchment area of Center for Independent Living. But no matter where they are in the state of California, the key thing is to go to the California for Independent Living Center Foundation.
CFILC.org.
Go there if nothing else, and eventually you should be able to find whether it's the Center for Independent Living in Berkeley. I guess other independent living centers or similar organizations throughout the state, but CFILC would be the place to go to.
Let me. Okay, so if you go to the CFILC.org website and you look for disability disaster. Why can't I find it? Anyway, I'm embarrassed. I've been up since 7 this morning, and I've been running around all day. I apologize. If you look for DDAR, there is a DDAR application there, and if you fill it out, what happens is it goes to some folks at CFILC, and they will figure out which independent living center. Not all independent living centers are DDAR centers, Disability Disaster Access and Response. Why won't my brain work? This isn't always like this. I'm embarrassed.
It's a long Friday.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They're not all disability, all CFILs. Try again. All independent living centers are not DDARCs.
Okay.
But if you fill out the application, they will figure out what is the nearest one to you and how to loop you in. What you need to know is, for the battery program, which everybody gets most interested in, you need to be in a fire-prone zone or have had at least 2 power outages that show that you are kind of at risk for this. But the batteries are, I'm not actually that knowledgeable about exactly how the batteries are work, but they're not, it's not like a house battery where you can plug it in and then recharge it when there's electricity, and it's very limited, but it's there. But these other things that we do, like we can get you in a hotel, and this means If you need accessibility in a hotel, we can do that. If you have pets, we can do that. If you, you know, we can help make things work. Okay. And that's the most important thing. I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, okay. A critical question I have, though, is can you folks only serve a limited number of people?
I don't know the answer to that. My answer would be, if someone needs help and they call me, we will do our best to figure out how to get them what they need. We're not the only universe. We aren't the only resource in the universe. And if we can't do it, there may be another way to get at it. We may liaison with other agencies and programs. We may support something else. Like if they need accessibility and there's another program that isn't quite accessible, but they need some help, maybe we bridge the gap. We haven't run into a thing where we can't help somebody because there's too many people. So I don't want to say that we can't help if there's too many people. What we may run into is that's more than we can do. And then we have to be clever and figure out how to get it done. And we will do our damnedest, and that's the best I can say.
What kind of organizations, whether it's community-based organizations or even the county health departments, have you actually made presentations with to inform these different folks about your service?
Well, I'm pretty new here. I started at the end of January, and I have actually only done one presentation so far, which was to the California Council of the Blind. But I have reached out to the Oakland CERT. I have reached out, which is a community emergency response team. It's part of the Oakland Fire Department. I've also reached out, oh dear, I forget what this stands for, BDPN, Berkeley Disaster Preparedness Network. I hope I got that right, David Petey, if you're listening. They do emergency preparedness stuff in Berkeley. I intend to reach out to the Berkeley emergency folks, to the Alameda City emergency folks, and to the Alameda County emergency folks. I have connected with the AFN folks, the Access and Functional Leads people.
Okay. And I think the music is coming on. But I wanted to ask you one more time, what's the best, quickly give your, again, your information if people want to get a hold of you in the program.
510-841-4776, extension 3190.
Okay.
510-841-4776, extension 3190. Take care. Be well, everybody.
Okay, Sheila. Thanks a lot for coming on today. And thank you very much, Rod Akil, for, again, engineering this session of Pushing Limits. We'll be back next week, 2:30 to 3, here on KPFA in Berkeley.
Featuring the Bay Area premiere of a piece based on Dr. Martin Luther King's stirring I Have a Dream speech. Special guests include the composer John Moss, Benjamin Mertz, and members of Vukani Mawetu. This wheelchair-accessible event to benefit La Peña Cultural Center will take place Saturday, March 25th at 7:30 p.m. at La Peña. Join us as we honor Dr. King in our collective struggle for freedom and social justice. For details and tickets, please visit www.lapena.org. That's www.lapena.org. You're listening to 94.1 KPFA and 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, and online at kpfa.org.